HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Dancing in the Mosque by Homeira Qaderi, performed by Ariana Delawari. To those who value and respect equality. Author's note. This is a work of nonfiction. The events and experiences detailed herein are all true and have been faithfully rendered as I have remembered them, to the best of my ability. Some names, places, identifying details, and circumstances have been changed in order to protect the privacy and/or anonymity of the various individuals involved. Prologue. Once upon a time, when there lived a merciful God, behind the mountains, in a distant city, a family was given a son with the nickname Shahpesar, one of regal descent. His real name was Mushtaq. Shahpesar was very handsome. He was his family's lucky charm. One day, to escape his boredom, the family's lucky charm began rummaging through his granny's storage closet. Shahpesar didn't know what he was looking for, but something drew him deeper into the dark, dusty interior. Suddenly, his hand closed on a heavy object. It was an old metal lamp. No sooner had he wiped the hem of his sleeve across the lamp's smooth surface than it became unbearably heavy and sparks shot out of its spout. Astonished, Shahpesar dropped the lamp. It hit the floor with a dull thud, rolled around in a circle, and stopped. A thick coil of smoke rose from the spout, curling toward the ceiling. A pair of stout legs materialized from the smoke, followed by a large belly, a barrel chest, muscular arms, and a huge head. The giant had a black beard topped with curly black hair. His black eyes glowed beneath heavy black eyebrows, and a golden earring dangled from his left earlobe, almost touching his shoulder. Looking down at the trembling boy, the genie bent down on one knee and said, "Hello, Master Mushtaq. I am at your service." Shahpesar took a quick step backward and said in a quivering voice, "Why at my service?" "Because you are the Shahpesar of the family," the genie said. "Your wish is my command."
"What kind of wish?"
"I am the king of all the genies. I am powerful enough to grant you anything you desire. I can take you anywhere you wish to go in the blink of an eye, or bring you anything you wish just as quickly."
"Bring me a black horse with a long mane and a gleaming coat."
The genie of the lamp bowed at the knee.
"And a strong hunting bow and eagle-feathered arrows," Shahpesar added.
The genie spun around three times, then three times more. Clapping his hands, he shouted,
"Oh, the long-maned black horse of the gleaming coat, appear from the darkness. Master Mushtaq wants to have fun and go hunting."
A cloud of smoke enveloped the middle of the room and turned into a black horse with a full mane and a long, graceful tail. The horse held a hunting bow in its mouth. Bowing down, the horse of the gleaming coat placed the bow at Shahpesar's feet and said,
"I am all yours, Master Mushtaq."
"Dear son, my grandmother, Nana John, never told me stories like that. In the stories she saved for me, there were no genies or magic wands to make my dreams come true. My stories were populated with wild monsters like Baba Ngorgori, Barzangi, Mardazma, Dokhtar Khor, and hundreds more. My grandmother had more monster stories than beads on her tesbeh. The purpose of her stories was primarily to keep me from playing with boys, cutting my hair, wearing short skirts, climbing trees, talking to the neighbor girl over the wall, laughing out loud, and ever arguing with Nana John. If I did any of those forbidden things, she would tell me, "A monster will appear out of thin air and drag me off to some horrible place where he will eat my flesh and lick my bones, or worse, make me his wife and force me to bear a brood of little hateful ogres." My grandmother believed that one of the most difficult tasks that the Almighty can assign anyone is being a girl in Afghanistan. As a child, I didn't want to be a girl. I didn't even want my dolls to be women. In those days, apparently, I knew more ways that led to hell than streets that led to my house. Nana John had told me so many stories about hell that I could describe every neighborhood in hell with my eyes closed. Which is why, when you were born, I was finally accepted and acceptable. At least I had done my duty. I was a mother in this tortured land, and I had produced a son. You, my dearest. But my motherhood didn't last long. I lost you early on to the cursed laws of the city when you were still a breastfeeding 19-month-old baby. It has been 985 nights since you were taken from me. It has been 985 nights since the howling wind wolves have ripped through my lullabies. Now that I am thousands of miles away from you, from all of you, in this small room in California, the only mark of the joy of your birth is the scar gracing my abdomen. It is my badge of motherhood. I heard that they've asked you about your mother and that you cried when told that your mother is dead. Do not believe them. I haven't died. I am living a life of exile in a place that has its own beauty, its own laws, and its own problems. But to my eternal pain, it does not have the most important element of my being, of my soul. It does not have you. 1. Bread and bullets. Afghanistan is the land of invisible bullets and the land of a death foretold, the land of doomed destinies and the land of dejected and disgruntled youth waiting forever for dreams that will never come true. This is how Maldad, my mother, Ansari, and Nana John, my grandmother, Firoza, described my homeland to me when I was barely 4 years old. In their eyes, Afghanistan was divided between the Russian occupiers and their communist government allies on the one side and the Mujahideen on the other. But for me, Afghanistan was divided between the street in front of our house where I played during ceasefires and the dangerous world beyond our walls when war returned and kept me stuck inside. I was a bright, playful child, too young and energetic to understand fear, whether of invisible bullets buzzing through the air or of Russian tanks rumbling in the street outside our house. Inside those walls, there was a courtyard filled with apple and mulberry trees and red and green grapes growing on the vine. We were three generations living there, Baba John and Nana John, their four daughters, my aunts, Kerbra, Hajar, Zora, and Aziza, my uncles Nasir and Bashir, Agha and Madar, plus my baby brother, Mushtaq, and me. Nana John always said, "A girl should have fear in her eyes." I spent a lot of time in front of the hallway mirror, examining my eyes to discover where the fear was hiding. Aunt Zara told me, "A girl's fear is right on her eyelids." I would turn my eyelids inside out, hoping to detect the shape or color of fear. My dad often said, "The night this girl was born, we were surrounded by fire. It felt like the city was giving birth. Before Homeira heard her own cries, she heard other people's screams. No wonder she isn't afraid of anything." Zara was 17 when she was struck by one of those invisible bullets while she was trying to pull me out of the grapevine and carry me to safety in the basement. My poor aunt fell down on her face. I could hear her gasping for breath. Blood was pouring out of her eyes. I stopped searching for the kittens and tried to find the invisible bullet in her eye, the place where a girl's fear is hidden. I can't remember a time when my homeland was not at war. My childhood began with jet fighter attacks, bombs falling from the sky, and me trying to count invisible bullets. War and hunger, those are my earliest memories. I remember my dad trying to breastfeed my brother, even after he was past the age of 2, because there was no food left to eat. Mushtaq chewed and bit my mother's breast. I heard my dad's quiet whimpering when she knew she had no milk left. During each attack, I watched Nana John tie her hijab tighter so that she wouldn't die without her veil and be thrown into hell in the hereafter. Even though she was illiterate, she often pretended to read the Holy Quran as she would run her index finger over the written lines of the scripture. She wanted to die a Muslim, holding the holy book close to her chest. And when I heard Baba John reading Surah Yasin, the chapter on God's sovereignty, the day of judgment, and a warning to non-believers, I knew that another bombing attack was coming. My childhood world was within the bounds of a small window, low in the wall of our house, and a mother who was always trying to keep me away from that window. She knew bullets could pierce glass. She tried her best to keep me surrounded by 4 solid cement walls. My mother was like a spider trying to safeguard me within her web. But I was a wild, stubborn baby spider. I kept tearing her web apart to escape. I never tired of the struggle to get outside. I was always looking for a chance to sneak into our walled garden. I wanted to be the first to discover the new bullet holes in the walls. I wanted to be the first one to touch the damaged trees and the burnt timber, to be the first to find the kittens hiding under our grapevine. Finding those invisible bullets was my most secret wish. I asked my mother, "Where do all these invisible bullets come from?" "Homeira," she said, smoothing my hair. "We cannot see where they come from, and we never see where they will go until they strike a tree, or a wall, or God forbid, a person." But there were good days too. I remember sneaking out of the house with Aziza on a day when there was no shooting. I remember the bright sunshine and the flow of a gentle wind of the season. I sat with my back against the sun-warmed wall of our house, playing in the dust and watching people passing by. I was totally unaware of the Russian tanks approaching on the nearby streets. During ceasefires, I had the habit of going to the smoldering rubble of the bombed houses to see the new ruins and how the gardens had been laid to waste. I wanted to see the crumbling walls, the broken windows, the smashed closets, and the shattered china. Once, in one of the houses that had been destroyed 3 or 4 days earlier, I saw a Russian soldier with his pants down. He was pressing his hand on the mouth of a neighbor's daughter. From behind the wall, I laughed at the Russian soldier's bare bottom. He heard my laughter. He quickly got up, put one hand between his legs, and with his other hand, he slapped me on my face until it burned. Then he spat in front of me. The girl used that moment to get up, put on her headscarf, and run away through the ruins. Later, I would laughingly tell everyone this story about how...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.